Shabbat shalom. What a wonderful day today is. This is a most fantastic Shabbat. How many of you like Shabbat? Woohoo! Right now we've got 211 cities in 13 countries.
Yay!
Thank you to all the live streamers. And as all of you know, how important is it to be a light in this dark world right now? I tell you, it's getting darker and darker all the time, which is why we're supposed to be getting brighter and brighter. And the way we get brighter and brighter is when we connect with other lights. That's why it's so important, especially on Shabbat, for all of us that are here locally, as well as the live streaming all over the U.S. and all over the world, for us to be a light to the nations, which is why here at El Shaddai, our goal is always being taking Torah to the nations, because the Torah is the light, as you all know from Proverbs 6. With that said, let's stand and we'll open with prayer and commit this day to our Abba. He loves us so much. Together. Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad Baruch Shem Kevod Mahuto Leolam Vayed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Praise be the name of his glorious sovereignty forever and ever. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart. And you shall teach them thoroughly to your children. And you shall speak of them when you sit in your house, when you walk on the road, when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and they shall be for a reminder between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and upon your gates. When the word entered the world, freedom entered it. And its highest teaching is love and kindness. And that is the whole Torah. Go and learn it. Honoring one another, doing acts of kindness, making peace. These are our highest duties. So let us learn in order to teach. It is a tree of life to those who hold fast, and all who cling to it find happiness. Its ways are ways of pleasantness, and all its paths are peace. Amen. Together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Mode ani lefaneka, melechai vikiyam, shehekazarta bi, nishmati bakemla, rabah emunateka. Thankful is what I am before your face, O King, living and eternal, for restoring my soul within me with compassion. Great is your faithfulness. Amen. Tell someone Shabbat shalom and have a seat. All right, our first announcement, you can be seated. Our first announcement is this coming Monday. Here it is Saturday, day after tomorrow, Monday night. We're going to have Rabbi Pesach Wolicki all the way from Israel here live. And with this being a Shemitah year, and it's all about freedom, he'll be speaking on the biblical meaning of freedom. We're looking forward to that. And then in just a couple of weeks, what do we have? February 19th to 20th, we're going to be having our meeting, our conference, a prophetic conference with several different speakers. And it is open to English speakers as well as Korean speakers. But guess what? You need to sign up because we're going to be supplying food for those of you that are here locally. So make sure if you're coming that you sign up. Now, also, just a final reminder, we have our tour coming to Turkey and Greece, and it's in just 7 months, a little less than 7 months. So if you want to go on this tour with us, you need to be signing up as quickly as possible, and I'm very excited. Now, I have one more announcement that I hate to make. Many of you know Bill Voice. He has cancer, and it's in his throat. It's throat cancer. And so he won't be here for about 3 months. He's going to be going through chemo and doing different things, but he wanted everyone to know just because he's not here is not because he doesn't support El Shaddai, but he has a battle that he believes he's going to win, and I believe it as well. But what we really covet, and I know what he really covets, is for all of you here locally, all of you around the world, to be praying for Bill Voice and for his family at this time. Amen? Amen. Curtis, would you come on up? Let's stand. We're going to have a song of worship and praise after the blowing of the shofar. Amen. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. He's great. He is great. Amen. You may be seated. Let's jump into the Torah portion. As most of you know, the Torah portion is called Terumah. And what does Terumah mean in English? An offering. Exactly. This isn't on your notes, but I can't help but think of Romans chapter 12, verse 1, where we're to present ourselves an offering, holy and acceptable to God, which says it's just our reasonable service. That's what we're supposed to do. We are, in one sense, to be a terumah, just as God, through Yeshua, offered his life up for us as well. And let's look at Exodus 25, verse 1 and 2, how it begins, where the Lord is speaking to Moses. And I always want you to remember, when it says the Lord is speaking rather than God is speaking, God refers to him as Elohim, the king, the judge. But when we read Lord, it refers to him as the God of mercy and loving kindness. And so we see here that the Lord is speaking to Moses, and he tells him to tell the children of Israel that they bring me a, what? But it's a free will offering. Nobody had to do it. He says, of every man that gives it willingly with his heart, you shall take my offering. I think that's incredible. I mean, sometimes people want to give you something and you don't want it because of the relationship you have with this person, all right? Or, but here God is saying, look, I only want what they're willing to give. The word terumah comes from two separate root words. One means to separate, and then the other one means to elevate. So you take something that belongs to you and you separate it from the rest, and then you elevate it as a way of, now I'm offering it up to the Lord. Now, the nice thing about this is God said this is to encourage everyone to donate as their heart prompts them. And that's what makes the project so special, because he didn't give a certain amount that everyone had to give. He said, just give what you want according to your heart. And so the nice thing is the tabernacle wasn't built by just the elite class or the wealthy who could afford it, but it was built by the people, everybody. So I just think it's important that that's what made it so beautiful, Moses' tabernacle, was it was totally made from the heart. It's not like they had to raise taxes. Let's look at verse 3 through 7. It says, and this is the offering. That's the word terumah. So God says, here's what I want you to take. I think it's interesting. It uses the word take. I thought it was an offering. I thought it was willing. Now you're taking it. But we have to understand there to take what was willingly offered. And what is it? The offering was of gold and silver and brass, all kinds of fine linen, ram skins, badger skins, wood, oil for the light, spices for anointing oil, for sweet incense, onyx stones, and stones to be set in the ephod and in the breastplate. What's important about this, first off, is like, where'd they get all this stuff? I thought they were slaves. They got it all from the Egyptians. So in one sense, even the Egyptians made an offering, and it's now being sanctified. But here's the other thing. When God told them what they were to bring to build the house, he is telling them what type of house he needs to dwell with them. They can't just build with any material. They can't pick what they want to build for him and how they want to build him. He is the architect giving them the plans of how they're to build the house. Okay, so that God is totally involved here. Now, let me show you this. In Exodus 25, verse 8, it says, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. You know what's really fascinating? I was going to mention this later, but I'll mention it now. Actually, the correct Hebrew translation is that I may dwell within them. And I think that's interesting. God wants to dwell within each one of us. And that's what he was really saying. But, and I don't mind if you take a picture of this, but this is what's important. There are different names for the tabernacle. Okay, he said to build me a sanctuary. Now, when he says sanctuary, the word is mikdash, which means a holy place. That means set apart. So you have to build a place that's set apart. And then we also know it's tabernacle. Well, that is the mishkan, which means a dwelling place where he's going to dwell. And then we also find it's called the tent of meeting, which really is Oel Moed, which means this is the meeting place. Okay, so the tabernacle is a holy place that's set apart. It's a dwelling place, and it's where at the appointed times they are to meet. And so we have a mikdash, and that is, okay, a holy place. Kadosh, kadosh, kadosh. Okay, is holy. A mikdash, that mem refers to a place that is holy. And then the other thing that it's called is a mishkan. How many heard of the Shekinah? Okay, shekan is to dwell. So it's not only a holy place, but the mishkan is also, that's the root word. And you add the mem to it, you get a dwelling place. Now, let me ask you this. How many of you know any famous architects? I don't know any famous architects. I know of them, but I don't personally know them. But what if this famous architect, I mean, we're talking the top architects of all time, come to you and they say, hey, would you build a house for me? You would say, you got to be kidding. You're the architect. You know, why is the best architect of all time asking me to build a house? Or you get a famous artist and a famous painter wanting you to paint them. Draw a paint. No, that's out of my league. Well, here, God of the universe, who created everything that there is, and give you an idea of how small we are, we're kind of over here somewhere, okay? And God says, I want you to build a place for me to dwell. I mean, this is mind-blowing to me. The creator, the greatest architect of all time wants us to build a place for him to live. I mean, that is just mind-blowing to me. So what I think is interesting is how God, in his love and his compassion, introduces himself as the creator of the universe. He doesn't do that. He doesn't introduce himself as the great architect. He just says, hey, build a place for me. Look who I am. Now you build, that would be kind of demeaning. I'm the best architect in the world. Now you build a place for me. That'd be kind of humiliating. But that's not what God does. He doesn't introduce himself like that. Now God is omnipresent. He inhabits eternity. How in the world would you build something for someone that inhabits, I mean, that's like building a small little box for an elephant. It don't work. Well, how are we going to build a place for God to dwell in? Well, listen to Psalm 139, verse 7 through 10. David is saying, where in the world can I go from your spirit? How can I go in flight from you? Jonah should have read that. He says, if I go up to heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in the underworld or the grave, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and go to the farthest parts of the sea, even there I will be guided by your hand and your right hand will keep me. Wow. So how in the world are we going to build a box that he's going to fit in? You know, how can the one who inhabits eternity, how can we create a limited, localized, finite space where his infinite presence can dwell? Well, here's what we need to understand. We need to look at it from a different perspective. The infinite space God is seeking It's not within the four walls of this building. It's not within the four walls of a church. It's within you. God wants to inhabit you. You are the place. But guess what? For him to mishkan or dwell here, the place has to be a mikdash, a holy place. So we need to, if we're the temple, as many Christians say, we got to clean the junk out of the temple so we can dwell there. Does that make sense? Okay, he wants to be in our heart. And only you. This is what's amazing. How many of you know God is all-powerful? And yet he will not force himself upon you. Only you can welcome him into your heart. And if you don't want to, that's up to you. That's why he is a melech, a king that only rules over voluntary subjects. Now, why would God, the source of all the gold, the silver, everything that's there, and the source of all exists, want material gifts from his kids? I mean, my first reaction is, well, God, you're the architect. Why don't you build it? And if we don't have any material, you know, why don't you just go, let there be gold? Just like you said, let there be light. How come you want us to supply the material to build it when you can just speak the tabernacle into existence? Why do you want work from us? Well, he knows, and here's the key, love grows when you invest yourself into something. The reason you love your children is because you're always investing into your children. Parents love their kids more than kids love their parents. Why? Because the parents are investing into the kids. The kids don't invest into the parents. So the reason God wanted the offerings and the sacrifices was because he knew if we brought something of ours willingly from our heart, that would make us want to love him more because now we're investing in the relationship. So if you want to fall more in love with God, you have to, and I'm not talking just money, I'm talking time, energy. With any relationship, time is so important. Does that make sense? Okay. I think what's amazing too is we all have to do it together. We can't build it if we're not working together. This is why it's so important with that we work together. Now, when you think of God creating the whole universe, to give you an idea of how humble God is, I can't help but think of, this isn't on your notes, but you all know it, Micah 6:6-8. It doesn't say he has told you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. It's he has shown you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you, to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly, not in front of your God, with your God. We have a humble God. Matter of fact, God, the creator of the universe, is so humble, he begins his name with the smallest letter of the Hebrew alphabet, the Yud, He, Vav, He. I mean, that is amazing. That just shows you how humble he is. And when you think about it, God, when he created the universe, and he wants to tell us all about him and himself, he devotes 32 verses to him creating the universe for us. But then he loves his kids. In the Torah, there's 450 verses that he says, look what my kids did for me. I think this is amazing. God loves to talk about what his kids built for him. And so there's all these verses in the Bible about what we did for him. It's kind of like a homemade card for a parent, you know, by your six-year-old or something. You love that and treasure that far more than any, you know, standard card you could buy at the store. And you put it on the refrigerator and you just love it. And so we need to realize, too, God is not looking at perfection
from us. He doesn't care if we color outside of the lines. What he wants is a heart that is toward him and does everything willingly. And I could do that. I could never build a house. Okay. The other nice thing about this Torah portion, what this is, it's our creation story. Here God creates this beautiful nursery, the Garden of Eden, and puts us in it, you know. And now we get a chance to build something for him. But here's the thing. When mankind built the tabernacle, we had to do it according to the pattern. Otherwise, just like if you go underwater, you're going to drown if you don't have a helmet with an air supply. Well, God is saying, if you want me to dwell with you, you got to do this or I can't dwell with you. So this is important. So here God created voluntarily a beautiful place for us to dwell in. And now he desires for us to build a beautiful place so he can dwell in it. Now, when God created the universe, he created it with laws. There's laws of physics, the laws of gravity. There's the water cycle, okay? So we can practically have a place to live in. Now, these laws have no effect to God. They only affect us. But now, again, he's asking us to create a place. And so he tells us what laws are required for building a place for him to dwell in. So what do we see? Again, Exodus 25:8, let them make me a holy place that I can dwell, and it's actually within them or inside them. And you know, this is huge. You know, this was always the plan. God wanted to live with us, and that's why he created the Garden of Eden. And then we got expelled, okay? And God's presence wasn't around manifest like it was then until the tabernacle. Moses' tabernacle. Well, guess what? The tabernacle got destroyed. The temples got destroyed. But we know in Revelation, at the end, it's all about him tabernacling with us again. And I think it's interesting, in Luke 17:21, God says, or Yeshua says, neither will they say, lo here or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is where? That's the way it's always supposed to be. Ben, he doesn't want to just dwell with us. He wants to dwell in us. This is why in 2 Corinthians 6:16, it says, what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God, and God has said, I will dwell where? In them and walk in them. I will be their God and they'll be my people. And as I said in Revelation 21, verse 1 through 3, John sees the new heaven, the new earth. The first one passed away. And then he says, I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband. And then I hear a loud voice out of heaven saying, behold, God's dwelling is with people and he will dwell with them. So from the beginning to the end, that always has been the plan of God. And it's our choice if we want to build a place within each of us for him to dwell, because the kingdom of God is within us. Now in 1 Corinthians 12:27, it says, you are the body of the Messiah and members individually. So we need to understand how corporately we're the tabernacle and members individually. Yes, in one sense, we're a temple, but we're not the complete temple until we're together with everybody. This is why in the Jewish thought, it's always the whole group. It's not just the individual. The Greek thought is it's all about me. I don't care what happens to you. I got mine. It's up to you to get yours. That's just the Western mentality, the Greek mentality. But for the Jewish people, it's, hey, we're all in the same boat. We're all in this together. And that's the kind of mindset that we need to have. Now, if the tabernacle is all about Yeshua, okay, because it's the body of the Messiah, look at this in 1 Peter 2, 4 through 6. Coming to him, Yeshua, who's a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God, precious. And now look at this. You also are living stones who are built up as a spiritual house. Okay, so we need to realize just as Yeshua is the chief cornerstone, each one of us are stones that make up the temple itself.
Now, I really believe in Revelation, when the temple comes down from heaven, it is made up, the walls are made up and the stones are made up of us. That's what's coming down. We become the living stones of the heavenly temple that comes down. Now, everything in the tabernacle was patterned after what was in heaven, right? Okay, so that means some of us are curtains, some of us are hooks, some of us are stones. We're all part of that material. Now, one of the other things that's really been hitting me this last week is when God gives the Ten Commandments, how does he identify himself when he gives the Ten Commandments? Now, let me put it this way. Let's say you're a judge, okay? And you have citizens. You're separate from the citizens because you're the judge. But now you hire one of these citizens as a law clerk to work for you. Okay, now in one sense, you have one hat you wear to the citizens, but with the employee, you have another hat on. Okay, and it's a little different relationship. But then all of a sudden we find out this employee is also the judge's son. Oh, now he has another hat. The judge is not only over the community, he has an employee, and the employee is also his son. But we know there's problems when things like that happens, because if there's a problem, which hat does he wear? The dad hat? Does he wear the boss hat? Does he wear the judge hat? And we know God has a lot of relationships with us. He's our king. But there's times he takes the king hat off and he puts on the dad hat. I'm your dad. Or I'm the judge now. And so when you think of all the different relationships we can have with God, I mean, he's our husband, but he's also our dad. He's also our brother. I mean, God shows you all the different hats that he can wear. Which one of these hats does he wear when he's giving the commandments? Does he wear the Elohim, I'm the boss, I'm the judge hat, you do what I say? Or does he wear the Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh hat, I'm merciful? We know sometimes when you extend mercy, what happens? People take advantage of it. So you've got to have the balance of what hat you're going to be wearing. Well, look at this. In Isaiah 16:5, it says, and in mercy is the throne going to be established. And in Exodus 20, verse 1 and 2, when God is giving the law, it says, I am who? I am the Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. I am the merciful one, your Elohim. And I'm the one who brought you out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. So the whole foundation of our relationship is with someone who said, I'm the one who broke your heart, your yoke. I'm the one who broke your chains. I'm the one who paid the price so you could be free. I'm the one who brought you out. I'm the one who wants to marry you. Oh my gosh, the problem with the commandments, many Christians see it as legalism, hard, mean. But when you realize the introduction, when he's bringing the commandments, is, look, I'm the one who freed you. And I'm the one who loves you. And just like you tell your child, you know, that's 6 years old, no, you can't play in the street outside at midnight. Okay, why? Because you want to be mean and you hate your kid? No, it's because you love them. So we have to understand all the commandments aren't some heavy tire chain around your neck. They're more like a necklace. Okay, with that said, I think when we think of how the temple is made up of each one of us, we're part of the tabernacle, listen to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 20 and 21. In a large house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and of clay. Some are for honor and some are for dishonor. If anyone therefore purges himself from these, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified, and suitable for the master's use, prepared for every good work. So the question we have to ask ourselves, when we come to building our temple for a place for Messiah to dwell, are we building with gold and silver and precious stones, or are we building with wood and clay or hay and stubble? And not only that, where will you be located within the tabernacle? Listen to Exodus 25:9. This is the key verse. He says, according to all that I show you after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the instruments, even so you shall make it. So even the offering needed to be according to the pattern. Now that Hebrew word is mareh, which means to mirror. In other words, it's like he has to mirror what's in heaven down on earth. And so we see in Exodus 26 verse 1, moreover, you're to make the tabernacle with 10 curtains, okay, a fine twined linen. And then in Exodus 26, verse 3 and 5, it talks about the five curtains. They're to be coupled one to another, and another five curtains coupled one to another. And then it talks about down at the last sentence there, 50 loops will you make with one curtain, 50 loops will make the edge of the curtain that is in the coupling of the second, that the loops may take hold one of another. Well, here it's talking about the curtains taking hold one of another. Well, if you look at this, and here's the Hebrew, and at the end it says coupled one to another, but those of you that know Hebrew, Isha is a word for a woman. El Akota. And there it is again, take hold one of another. And so what this is referring to is like each curtain is a woman with her sister holding hands. So think of the tabernacle as the curtains, what's holding everything together are sisters. But they have to be, if you don't hold together, what happens? The tabernacle falls apart. Now, The word for curtain here is yir-i-ah. And what's fascinating about that is let's go on for a minute and look at Exodus 26, verse 36 and 37. It says, you're also to make a hanging for the door of the tent of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twined linen worked with needlework. And you're to make for the hanging, five pillars of shittim wood and overlay them with gold, and their hooks will be of gold, and you will cast five sockets of brass for them. Guess what the Hebrew word for a hook is? That is the thing that hooks everything together. It is exactly right. It is the letter vav. And the letter vav are like the tent stakes, okay, that go down into the thing that's holding all the curtains and everything down to the earth. So we have the vav, which means a hook. So actually what this is kind of doing, when the Shekinah fell, what this is doing, we're hooking God's presence down to the earth. So just as the tabernacle was the habitation of God while they were in the wilderness, the Torah is the habitation of his word today. Look at Exodus 40:18. It says, and Moses reared up the tabernacle, fastened his socket, set up the boards, and put in the bars, and reared up his pillars. Well, that word is amud, which means columns. So you think of the columns that are between the curtains as well. So here we have the curtain, their sheets, all right? Well, what's amazing is every single Torah scroll is made up of curtains or sheets. It is made up also of columns, all right? And if you come up here and look, every column begins with a word that begins with the letter vav, connecting one column to the next. So the Torah scroll in its creation is patterned after Moses' tabernacle with columns and sheets and hooks. It's totally amazing. And in case you didn't know, there are 304,805 letters in the Torah, 248 columns in the Torah scroll. There are
roughly 50 curtains, like the Torah says, that all of it is written on. There's 42 lines, 6 times 7, in every column of a Torah scroll. And as I said, the first word in every column begins with a word that begins with the letter Vav. There's only 5 exceptions to the whole Torah scroll, which is fascinating. Okay, let's go to Mark chapter 12, verse 35 through 37. This is from the Brit Hadashah. It says, in addition, Yeshua taught in the temple by asking, now how can the scribes teach that the anointed one or the Messiah is the son of David? How do you know the son of David is the Messiah has to be a son of David? Does everyone realize that? From the tribe of Judah, the Messiah has to be a son of David. And yet, Yeshua tells them, well, David himself said by the Holy Spirit, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Well, since David himself calls him Lord, how then can be his son? Okay, well, now wait a minute. If the Messiah is supposed to be the son of David, but David calls him his Lord, then that means that how can this be, right? Well, listen to Psalms 110, verse 1 that Yeshua is quoting here. It's a psalm of David. And here it is. The Lord said to my Lord, be seated at my right hand till I make all those who are against you under your feet. So David had to be speaking of the Messiah. So this is telling us that Yeshua was not only the son of David, but he also is the Messiah who came long before David ever existed. Look at verse 4 through 6 of this same psalm. This is David writing. The Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh has made an oath and won't take it back. You are a priest forever. Was he talking about David there? David was from the tribe of Judah. He can't be a priest. So he's referring to the Messiah. And he said after the order of Melchizedek, in the day of his wrath, which is coming very soon, kings will be wounded by the Lord at your right hand. Who's at the right hand? The Messiah. He will be judge among the nations. The valleys will be full of dead bodies. The head over a great country will be wounded by him. I wonder the head of which country, great country today, is going to be wounded by him. But I tell you what, this is definitely the Messiah that he's talking about. And so for someone to be his son, but also pre-exist before him, tells you the divinity of Yeshua as the Messiah. Wow. With that said, let's stand. And we'll close with prayer, and then we'll have a break. Then we'll begin worship, and then yay. Are you ready? Avinu Melkeinu, our Father, our King, we just thank you so much for your living word. Father, we just pray you would take the veil off of the eyes of our understanding. Father, that we would just fall in love with you and realize that all of your commands are for our good, and you just love us and you want us to give to you willingly, from our heart, to invest in you so you would know that we truly do love you, and we want to increase our love for you. Father, I just thank you for all those here locally, all those around the United States and even around the world who give into your ministry of taking the Torah, the light, to all the nations of the world. Father, we want to stomp on the devil's head. We want to crush him under our feet. We don't want to believe the lie that we just love you and serve you because we want to go to heaven. We don't want to go to hell. But Father, we love you just because we love you with all of our heart willingly. Let not the devil throw it in your face that your people only serve you because of what you offer. No, we serve you because we want to serve you. Let the devil be forever silenced as we stomp on his head. And we just thank you,
Father, and we just pray that we could continue to will and to do of your good pleasure. Father, we are overcomers. We're going to overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil. And we also just lift Bill's voice up to you at this time as well, Father, that he would overcome this throat cancer. And Lord, we're just going to put our trust in you. In Yeshua's name, amen. Together, blessed are you, Lord our God, creator and king of the universe. You have blessed us with your Torah of truth. You have blessed us with the whole soul of your living word by the power of your Holy Spirit through the completed work of Messiah Yeshua. You alone have planted among us life eternal. Blessed are you, Lord our God. Amen. Take a break. Yeah? Well, good. All right, we got about 30 seconds. 30 seconds. Where's our shofar blower, Josh? There he is. All right. And now, again, if you want a fellowship, feel free to have fun in fellowship, but not in this area where we're worshiping. So, Josh, come on up. All right, let's stand. We're going to blow the shofar, and then we'll begin our time of worship. Lord, we just lift this time up to you right now, and we just pray, Father, that you would give us all hearing ears. And even as the shofar is blown, may it break up any stones in our hearts or lives, Father, that we would be tender before you in Yeshua's name. Amen. Take it away.
Holy, holy, there is the God of Israel. That's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. So Savior, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Failures, Lord, fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. So now I surrender. Oh, we surrender. Savior, You can move the mountains. My God, He's mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Oh, shine Your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Oh, Jesus, shine Your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and Jesus conquered the grave. We sing, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Oh, shine Your light and let the world. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the
I feel the rains of your love, feel the winds of your love.
Amen and amen. Before we pray here, I just wanted to mention also, many of you know Troy and Kathy Mails. Troy was running our camera. Well, Kathy passed away this last week. Many of you know she's been suffering the last, you know, couple of years with cancer. But anyway, so pray for them as well. And let's just pray. Avinu Mokenu, our Father, King, we just want to lift up the Mails family. Father, and we just pray that you would be with them, that you would comfort them, show them how much you love them, that they would have your strength and your peace ruling and reigning in their house. We thank you that Kathy is with you, rejoicing right now. We rejoice for her, sad for us. But Father, we just thank you. We know she ran the race, and we know that she ran it well. We just thank you for her. And Father, so many of the sheep of your pasture are sick or injured. And so, Lord, right now we want to lift up all of our loved ones that have an illness of some kind, maybe a physical injury, COVID, or whatever it may be. We know that you are the great physician. You are the great healer. And so, Father, we just lift up all those who have any physical ailments, but also those who have psychological or emotional ailments as well. And those who maybe don't even know you, they're far from you. We know time is short. And so, Father, we pray you would bring people into the paths of our loved ones, Lord, that they would be able to bring the good word. It may not come from us because of the relationship, but we know that there are people that you can bring into their paths. We just lift up our loved ones that don't know you. And, Father, pray that you would bring them back to you. And also for those who have financial needs, we pray that you would open the windows of heaven and meet the needs of all those who need a job or a home or a car or whatever it may be. We just pray financial blessings upon them, Father, that it may even come from sources that they know not of. We just thank you. And Father, for the nations of this world, all those who are live streaming and those here in the United States, we just lift up our national political leaders to you as well, military, religious leaders. Father, we see a great falling away taking place even among the church. Father, we just lift up our leaders. We pray that your will would be done right here on earth as it is in heaven. We also want to lift up the nation of Israel at this time as well. Father, that you would, again, guide your people, that they would all turn back to the Torah and turn back to you. Father, protect them from the enemy. In Yeshua's name, amen. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Before we jump into the lesson, I always like to say hi to all of those, not to all of those, but to those who contacted us saying that they are here and watching. Believe it or not, so far this morning, we've had people from Bermuda, Barbados, Australia, Canada, Aruba, of course, the Yukon, Sweden, Scotland, Cayman Islands, Kenya, the UK, Holland, and Germany. Wow, that is crazy. And then, of course, in the United States, we have people from, of course, Washington State here, but Hawaii, California, Oklahoma, Oregon, Tennessee, Iowa, Arizona, South Carolina, Alabama, Texas, North Carolina, Florida, Ohio, Nevada, North Dakota, Missouri, Wyoming, and Pennsylvania. Let's give them all a big hand. Yay! We are so grateful for all of those who are watching. Okay, are you ready? We're going to jump into the adventures, the life and adventures of Shaliach Shaul. Now, who remembers who Shaliach Shaul is? Yeah, that's right. That's where the word apostle or someone who has been sent. This is the Hebrew word for Shaliach, one who is sent or an apostle. And Shaul was his Hebrew name. In English, we say Saul. But he also had another name, Paul. But just so you know, God did not give him that name, Paul. Several of the apostles and people back then always had second names for various reasons. And if you remember last week, we stopped short of all the notes. So this week, I have some of those notes, but I've also added more notes. And so we're going to go and begin with Acts chapter 9, verse 27 and 30. Rabbi Shaul has been knocked off his high horse, and Barnabas is taking him to the apostles and gave the apostles. Now, the apostles are all in Jerusalem, so we have to know he's in Jerusalem. And he gave them an account of how Rabbi Shaul has seen the Lord on the road and had given hearing to his words, and how even at Damascus, you know, Rabbi Shaul has been preaching in the name of Jesus without fear. And he was with them while they're in Jerusalem, going in and out of Jerusalem. He was preaching in the name of the Lord without any fear. And look at this. He had discussions with who? Okay, what's another name for the Greek Jews? Hellenists. That's right. If you remember 168 BC and the whole story of Hanukkah and Antiochus Epiphanes, it was the Hellenists, or the Greek Jews, who wanted to follow what Antiochus is saying. And it says they were working for his death. These Greek Jews were wanting to kill him. And then when the apostles and the brothers had knowledge of it, they took him to Caesarea and sent him to Tarsus. Now, where does he live? Tarsus. Okay, so here's our map so we can look at. Here he's in Jerusalem, and then he heads over to Tarsus. Let me see what I've got here. He started right there in Jerusalem. They take him to Caesarea, we just read, and then they send him by boat to Tarsus. You can see where Tarsus is. That's where he's home. So now we know he is in Tarsus. Okay, so now it says some of them, this is Acts 11, we're going to jump over there. Acts 10 is Peter and the sheet coming down from heaven. We're now in Acts 11. And I thought this was interesting. It says some of them were men of Cyprus and Cyrene. That island right there in purple is Cyprus. So here are people other than Paul from Cyprus. They came to Antioch, where Paul was, and they spoke to the Grecians. Now, I don't think that they are speaking to Gentile Grecians. They're speaking to the Hellenistic Jews, okay? And they're preaching Yeshua, and the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number of believed. And they turned to the Lord, and then it says, tidings of these things came into the ears of the church in Jerusalem. And so they sent Barnabas that he should go as far as Antioch. Okay, so there's Antioch now. Here, in case you weren't watching, there's Antioch right there. Okay, this is the Antioch in Syria. So Barnabas is in Jerusalem. He goes up, and what does it say? In Acts 11, 25, verse 26, it says, then departed Barnabas, where? To Tarsus. He's looking for the apostle Paul to seek Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. So Paul was in Tarsus where he lived. Then he goes to Antioch, and it says he's there for an entire year, assembled with the assembly, and he taught much people, and the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch, Syria. Now let's go look at the very next verses, 27 and 28. It says, in these days came prophets from Jerusalem up to Antioch, and there stood up one of them named Agabus, and he signified by the Spirit that there would be a great famine or dearth throughout all the world. And it came to pass in the days of who? Claudius Caesar. Historically, if you want to start a timeline, Claudius Caesar reigned from 41, the year 41, to the year 54. Okay, so if you're trying to do a timeline, I love timelines. We see that the famine happened sometime in that 14-year time period, from 41 to 54. But we're going to get things narrowed down. Look at this. So because there was a famine coming, the believers in Antioch wanted to send food down to Jerusalem. And so it says in Acts 11, 29, then the disciples, every man according to his ability, determined to send relief to the brethren which dwelt in
Judea, which also they did, and they sent it to the elders by the hands of Barnabas and Saul. Okay, so now he's going back to Jerusalem again. Well, guess what? In Acts 12, the very next chapter, look what happens in verse 21 through 25. Here it says, and on a day which had been fixed, Herod dresses in his robes and seated in his place, he makes a public statement to them. And then it says, the people with loud cries said, oh, it's the voice of a god and not of a man. And straightway the angel of the Lord sent a disease upon him because he didn't give the glory to God. His flesh was wasted away by worms and he came to his end. But the word of the Lord went on increasing. And so Barnabas and Saul went back to Antioch from Jerusalem when their work was ended. And now they took with them John, who is what? Named Mark. Okay, so several of the disciples had more than one name. What's interesting is you can read Josephus talks about Herod dying, in this instance, and he died actually about a week later, roughly is what it was. But here's what's amazing. When you also go back and you look at historical timelines, Herod died in 44 AD. Okay, so Claudius Caesar's the Roman emperor from 41 to 54. This event right here happened in 44, the year 44. That's when Herod died. Okay, now Barnabas and Saul, they go back to Antioch from Jerusalem. Now comes Acts 13, verse 2, which is Paul's first missionary journey. And when you go and you research, when did he do his first missionary journey? It's like approximately 47, the year 47. So it's about 3 years after Herod dies. And so it says in Acts 13, 1 and verse 2, while they were doing the Lord's work and what? Going without food. The Holy Spirit said, let Barnabas and Saul be given to me for the special work for which they've been marked out by me. And then look at the next verse. Then, after prayer and going without food, they put their hands on them. They sent them away. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia. From there, they went by ship to Cyprus. And at Salami, they were preaching the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews. And John was with them, helping them. Okay, John named Mark. Okay, he decided to go with them. So let's take a look at our maps here again. Okay, so here we are. We're over in Antioch. And we go over to Seleucia, where that red arrow is. They get on a boat. They go over to Salami in Cyprus. And then you're going to find they're going to head over to Paphos. And then they're going to go up to Perga in Pamphylia. All right, so let's watch this as this unfolds. It says in Acts 13, 6 through 12, when they had gone through all the island to Paphos, they came across a certain wonder worker and a false prophet. This is a Jew whose name was Son of Jesus, who was the ruler who was with the ruler, Sergius Paulus, an able man. Well, Sergius Paulus sent for Barnabas and Saul, wanting to have knowledge of the word of God. But this guy, whose name was Bar-Jesus, also had a name called Elymas, which means basically wonder worker. And he put himself against them with the purpose of turning the ruler from the faith, but Saul, whose other name was Paul, being full of the Holy Spirit, looked at this guy and he said, oh, you who are full of false tricks and evil ways, you're a son of the evil one, hating all righteousness. Will you forever be turning people from the right way of the Lord? And now, see, the hand of the Lord is on you and you're going to be blind and not able to see the sun for a time. And straightway a dark mist came down him. He went about looking for a guide. And then the ruler, when he saw what was done, had faith, being full of wonder at the teaching of the Lord. So he ends up getting saved. Now, what happens in Acts 13, verse 13 and 14? Paul and his companions. And who are his companions? Barnabas and John Mark. Okay, look what happens. They came to Perga in Pamphylia. Okay, so here is
Perga, Pamphylia. Now, all of this is modern-day Turkey. You want to understand, all of this is happening in modern-day Turkey. Okay, but he goes over there to Perga in Pamphylia, and look what happens. John deserted them. Ooh. And he returned to Jerusalem. But they went on from Perga and came to Antioch in Pisidia. Not the Antioch in Syria, but the Antioch in Pisidia. I can tell you right now, there is a rift that is happening between Paul and John Mark. Okay? There are problems. How many of you know they were just as dysfunctional back then as we are now? Okay? And they have personality conflicts. And John Mark is not happy, I guess, with Paul's evangelistic methods. So he bolts and he says, I'm out of here. I'm going to go tell the apostles. Okay. So off he goes. Now we find, if we look back at our map, here they're now at Antioch in Pisidia, which is part of the big area of Galatia. See, here's the Antioch in Syria. There's an Antioch in Pisidia, which is in the region of Galatia. And look at this. They're meeting on the Sabbath day. What? I thought they did away with the Sabbath day. No, we're in the New Testament, we're in the book of Acts, and they're still meeting on the Sabbath. And they're going into the synagogue. What? I thought they met house to house. No, they met in the synagogue with the other Jews. Now, in Acts 13:26 is an important verse. Paul is speaking, and he mentions three categories of people. So I want you to know who all is in the synagogue. He mentions first brothers. These are the fellow Jews. Then he mentions sons of the family of Abraham. These are converts, okay? These are people who've converted to Judaism. And then he says, and those among you who fear God. Those are the non-Jews who didn't convert, think they had to become Jews, but still, just like the soldier in Capernaum, he was a Gentile who feared God. Okay, and he helped the Jews. He helped build the synagogue and this kind of thing. So there are three different people, the Jews, the converts, and the non-Jews who just fear God. And they're all meeting in the synagogue. And he says, to us has been sent this message of salvation or Yeshua. And then we go to verse 43. And after the meeting of the synagogue broke up, many Jews and devout converts, that's referring to the sons of Abraham who were converts. Right there, it tells you that. And it says, they urged them to continue in the grace of God. So all is well. But what happens? The next Sabbath, the whole city comes to hear the word of the Lord. But when the Jews in that particular synagogue, not Jews, in all of Judea, in all of Israel, not the Jews around the world, the one in this particular synagogue, were filled with jealousy. Okay, wow, he's going to start another synagogue and take money away from our synagogue. Or that guy sitting in my chair. I can't have all these converts and these non-Jews sitting in my chair. Okay, and a lot of, for a long time, the Jews paid for chairs. They would pay for seats. That is my seat. I paid for that seat. That's when they raised funds. And now there's a Gentile in my seat. Okay, so a lot of this was just what would happen if all of a sudden, you know, 1,000 people showed up in the building. It's like, hey, what are we going to do? And so we find they begin to contradict what was spoken by Paul. But they only contradicted it because they were jealous. So Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly, saying it was necessary the word of God be spoken first to you, since you thrust it aside and judge yourselves unworthy of eternal life. Behold, we're turning to the Gentiles. Well, guess what? The very next verse, he goes back to the synagogue. And so when he said we're turning to the Gentiles, that wasn't to be seen as, okay, we can't witness to the Jews anymore. We got to witness to the Gentiles. What that tells us is Paul had an attitude. That's what it just says. He didn't say all Jews in every nation, because what does he do? He goes right back and continues speaking to the Jews in the synagogue. All right. So Paul has an attitude. That's what we learned. Now, Acts 13:50 through 52, it says, but the Jews who were, they incited the devout women of high standing and the leading men of the city, stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas, drove them out of their district, but they shook off the dust from their feet against them, and they went to where? Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy in the Holy Spirit. Now look at this in Acts 14. Now at Iconium, they entered where? Into the Jewish. I guess he wasn't done with the Gentiles or with the Jews. Here it says, I'm turning to the Gentiles. And the very next moment, he goes into a Jewish synagogue. So that tells you that isn't some biblical thing. It's a matter of that just tells you, you know, he was mad. Okay, so what, let's go here. He was in Antioch and Pisidia, and now he's going to go to Iconium, Lystra, and Derbe. Follow the red line. Okay, so let's look what happens. Acts 14, verse 1 and 2. Now at Iconium, they entered together into the Jewish synagogue, and they spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and who else? But it's Hellenists. You following me? These are Greek-speaking Jews. They're Greek, but they are Greek-speaking Jews. They all believed. But the unbelieving Jews, so in other words, you have to understand, you can't classify all Jews did something. No, you got the believing Jews and the unbelieving Jews. And they stirred up the Gentiles, poisoned their minds against the brothers. Okay, so what do we find? They now go to Lystra. And so look what happens in Acts 14, 4 through 7. And the people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews, some with the apostles, or the Messianic Jews. And when an attempt was made by both Gentiles and Jews with their rulers to mistreat them and to stone them, they learned of it and they fled to Lystra and Derbe, cities of Lycaonia, to the surrounding country, and there they continued to preach the gospel. So we see they went from Iconium to Lystra and then to Derbe. Okay, so watch what happens while they were in Lystra. Now, at Lystra, there was a man sitting who could not use his feet. He was crippled from birth and had never, ever walked. And then he heals him. Now look what happens in verse 11 through 15. When the crowd saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices and they said in their own language, the gods of heaven have come down to us in the likeness of men. And Barnabas they called Zeus and Paul Hermes because he was the chief speaker. And then the priest of Zeus, whose temple was at the entrance of the city, brought oxen. Okay, and garlands to the gates and wanted to offer sacrifice with the crowds. But when the apostles Barnabas, wow, everybody knew Barnabas was an apostle too. The apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of it. They tore their garments and rushed out into the crowd, crying out, men, why are you doing these things? We also are men of like nature with you, and we bring you good news that you should do what? Turn from these vain things to a living God who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. Okay? And then look at this next verse 18. And with these sayings, they barely could restrain the people that had not done, that they wouldn't do sacrifice to them. Now watch this. How many of you have known someone and they were all lovey-dovey and then the very next instant they turned on you and were ready to kill you? That happened in the Bible too. Here they're worshiping Paul and Barnabas, calling them gods, and the next instant they're ready to kill him. Look, it's right here. Jews came from Antioch and Iconium, and having persuaded the crowds, what did they do? Now they stone Paul and they drag him out of the city, supposing he was dead. Oh my goodness, they're ready to worship him at one moment, and the next moment they turn and they try to kill him, and they thought they did kill him. And so what happens, they thought he was dead, but when the disciples gathered around him, they probably had all ran away, and now after he's alone and laying in the street, they come back to check on him. He rose up and entered the city, and the next day he went on with Barnabas to Derbe. And when they had preached the gospel to that city and had made many disciples, they go back to Lystra and Iconium and to Antioch.
Oh my goodness, he's not afraid. He doesn't run away. He goes right back to the very same places that had caused him trouble. But here's the big point I want to make. Look at every one of these cities, Antioch, Iconium, Lystra, Derbe, are in what territory? Galatia. When you read the book of Galatians, which is so misunderstood, unless you connect back to the book of Acts and find they were people that worshiped Zeus and Hermes and all the planets, you're not going to understand the book of Galatians. This is why I have to set the stage first before I go into the book of Galatians, which is all about the law. We have to explain the setting. And I want you to find it was in Galatia where the pagans were all worshiping the sun, the moon, the stars, Zeus. Very important. And you're going to see why as we go. Okay. So we go to Acts 14, verse 24 through 28. Then it says they passed through Pisidia and came to Pamphylia. All right. Well, you're going to find right. Let me see. Pisidia. Yep. Pamphylia. Here's Pamphylia. And they're going to go to Attalia, which is right there close to Perga. Okay. It says, and when they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Attalia. And then from there, they sailed to Antioch. Okay, so before they took the boat over to Perga, but on the way back, they stop at Attalia, and they go back over to Antioch. This is his first missionary journey. And it says, when they had commended to the grace of God the people for the work they had fulfilled, when they arrived and gathered the assembly together, they declared all that God had done with them, how he opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. And they remained no little time with the disciples. So they stayed a while there back in Antioch talking about that first tour and everything that we had just read. Then what happens in Acts 15, verse 1 and 2? Certain men which came down, Jerusalem is considered high, Judea, they're going down over to Antioch. It says, they came and taught the brethren, and they said, except you're circumcised after the manner of Moses, you cannot be saved. And when therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them have to go up to Jerusalem to speak to the apostles and the elders about this big debate. And so in verse 5 and 6, it says, there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which were believers, they're Messianic Jews, and they were saying it was necessary to circumcise them and command them to keep the law of Moses, and the apostles, the elders came together to consider the matter. Okay, now comes this big debate. So let's look at verse 11 through 14. It was said, we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we will be saved even as they. So they, the Jews believe that they're saved by grace through faith. And they're saying, well, the Gentiles are going to be saved the same way. And then all the multitude shut their mouth. And they gave audience now to Barnabas and Paul, who declared the miracles and wonders that God had wrought among the Gentiles. And after they had held their peace, here comes James. And he answers. And he said, men and brethren, listen to me. Simeon has declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles to take them out of people for his name. Okay, if you remember, Acts 10 has already happened. That's why they talked about Acts 10 and Peter seeing the sheet coming down from heaven, going to Cornelius. So Peter, the top dog there, he had witnessed how God was calling the Gentiles. And so he's there part of this discussion. And we see in verse 16 and 17, he's... Now they're quoting from Amos. And in Acts 15, verse 19 through 21, they say, wherefore my sentence, Acts 15, 16, and 17. After this, I will return and will, wow, this is interesting. I will return and build the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down. I will build again the ruins thereof and set it up. And look at this,
that the residue of men might seek after the Lord and all the Gentiles upon whom my name is called. So God is calling Gentiles. The Gentiles don't become Jews. You don't have to look for what tribe you're from. Just know that even as you are, God loves you. He accepts you. And it's the Lord who does all these things. So God is saving the Gentiles as well. And now we come to Acts 15, 19 through 21. They say, wherefore, the sentence is this, that we don't trouble them which from among the Gentiles are turned to God. Now here comes the verse that is so misunderstood. So listen to what they said. We want to write to them, the Gentiles, the non-Jews who are coming to the faith in the Messiah, that they abstain from the pollution of idols and from fornication and from things strangled and from blood. Now, they say this again in a few verses, and I'll explain it more then. But first, I wanted to let you know, this whole thing has nothing to do with salvation. Every one of these things they just mentioned is about going to the temple prostitutes, going to the Greek temples. That's what they would do. They would be involved with the pollution of idols. They would be involved with fornication at the Greek temples. They would eat things that are strangled, and they would eat blood. And so what they're saying is this. You're going to see this more coming. Look at this. Very next verse. For Moses of old time has in every city those that preach him, being read in the synagogues every what? What they're saying is, look, if the Gentiles are going to come in the synagogue and learn about Moses, the first thing they do is have to quit going to their pagan temples. If you think that this means that that's all they have to do to be saved, then you're saying you're saved by works. And those are the works. And then now you can murder, you can do all these other things because that wasn't in the list. Well, the list had nothing to do with salvation. The list is this. Just like how many of you would want a drug dealer to come into our service and try to sell drugs to people? Like, no. If you want to come here, you got to quit selling drugs. It's a matter of fellowship. This whole verse has nothing to do with salvation. It had to do with they have to quit what they're doing and start. Then they can come. Look right there. It says, then they're going to come every Sabbath and hear Moses taught. That's what it says. As a matter of fact, look at 1 John 5, 2, and 3. By this we know we love the children of God when we love God and do what? Keep his commandments. And that's from the Apostle John in the New Testament. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. It's only grievous to lawbreakers. It's a thief who gets mad he can't steal. Okay. So look at Acts 15, 22. Then it pleased the apostles and the elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company back to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas, namely Judas, surnamed Barsabbas, and Silas, chief men among the brethren. Okay, so here are some false teachers were in Antioch, grab Paul and Barnabas, said, let's go to Jerusalem, figure out what they have to say. They found out what they said. Now they go back to Antioch to let everybody know that what they were doing was correct. And then, but this time they're bringing Silas. Very important to realize this. Now in Acts 15, 24, it says, for as much as we've heard, certain which went out from us have troubled you with words, subverting your soul, saying, you must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such commandment. Okay, I have, just to clear up some confusion around here sometimes, we do Passover, you know, as we used to do it as a big group by 1,500 people, but then we broke it down to just family, and then COVID came, so we haven't been doing a group Seder for a while. But oftentimes Gentiles will come to me and says, well, can I go to your Seder? I'm not circumcised. And I'll say, guess what? There's no temple. It doesn't matter. number one, you can do Passover because this is a memorial. It's not, there is no temple, there is no Passover lamb. It doesn't matter. Okay. Now, let's see. Where am I? Okay. But the other thing you have to understand, so the Gentiles don't have to be circumcised. It's all about you're saved by grace through faith. And when they sing, we gave no such commandment, what they're saying is also, and keep the law, the Jews never saw keeping the law save them either. They never saw that as a tool of salvation. In other words, think of this. Your dad, is your dad going to go tell the neighbor kids to mow your lawn? No, he tells his own kids to mow the lawn. The way that you see the commandments is not to become God's kids. He's commanding it to us because we already are his kids. So the whole thing was never a salvation issue. It's like, I got to do what dad said. You following me? That's so important to get that. Okay, so now, here's the other thing. When you read the word law in the New Testament, you have to know what law he's talking about. When they talk about the law of sin and death, is the law of sin and death done away with? Is the law of gravity done away with? There's a lot of laws. There's the oral law, the Talmud. So you have to know, is he speaking about the written law or the oral law? There's a lot of different things you have to understand when you're reading the text. For example, Romans 8:2, the law of the Spirit. What? There is a law of the Spirit. It's of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. So we see a couple of different laws here. So when we say we're dead to the law, we're talking about the law of the Spirit, okay, or the law of sin and death. Well, neither one of those is the law of Moses. And so you have to understand what law is being discussed here. Now, here's the other thing that I was thinking about that really hit me the other day. Think about this for a minute. The Gentiles do not become Jews. Why is this important? First off, how many of you, if your parents die, you get this big inheritance, and the neighbor comes and says, I get a part of that too. Like, what? You're not even, what are you talking about? In Israel, the inheritance was the land. So if a Gentile becomes a Jew, what tribe does he belong to? Does I belong to the tribe of Levi, therefore I get to be a priest, let me in. Or, hey, I decided I'm from the tribe of Judah, I'm a Gentile, converted to the Jews, so I'm from the tribe of Judah, so I get to be king. Or, I'm from the tribe of Judah, I want to go live in the land of Naphtali, so you guys have to give me some of your land for free because I'm from the tribe of Naphtali. Can you see what the big problem was with all these converts? All these converts that are coming in want to live in Israel. Where are they going to live? Who's going to give up their land to give these yahoos a piece of land forever? Do you see what the conflict was also, just from a human point of view, with these Gentiles converting to the faith? Who wants to give up their land? I want you to understand the setting of what's going on here and why there was such a problem. Or let's say a Gentile says, I'm from the tribe of Naphtali. And then all of a sudden he lives in that area and they kick him out. And so he moves over to the tribe of Asher. Okay, now I'm from the tribe of Asher because I had to move. I mean, it just doesn't, this was the problem back then. So the real question is, who's your daddy? Okay, because the dads determine what tribe you're from. You're saying you're from this tribe or that tribe. Who's your daddy? Let's look at the genealogy. Okay, so let's go to verse 27 through 30. We've sent, therefore, Judas and Silas, who also are going to tell you of the same things by mouth, for it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things. Here it is again. That you abstain from meats offered to idols. Do you know what that is referred to in Acts chapter 10 when Peter sees the vision? Peter said, I have not eaten anything that is common or unclean. When he says unclean, he's referring to unclean foods in Leviticus. When he says, I haven't eaten anything common, that refers to kosher food that's been offered to an idol. Now it's common because that's what everybody did. They would offer their food up to an idol and then they take it home and eat it because they want to be blessed by the God they offered up the food to, just like saying grace before meals. They'd say it to their God. And so he's saying, you abstain from meat offered up to idols and from blood, from things strangled, from fornication, from which if you keep yourselves, you'll do well. Fare thee well. So when they were dismissed, they all came to Antioch and then they tell everybody. But again, if you are a Christian reading this thinking, see, that's all Christians have to do to be saved, whatever happened to the Ten Commandments? They're not even listed here. Does that mean you can break all the Ten Commandments now? No. This had nothing to do with salvation. It had to do with, this is what you have to do before you can come every Sabbath and learn about Moses. We don't want you, anything defiled, coming into a holy place. And so what happens in Acts 15, 34 through 41? It pleased Silas. See, Silas goes up to Antioch. He came from Jerusalem with Barnabas and Saul. He decides to stay there. Paul also and Barnabas continued in Antioch, teaching and preaching the word of the Lord with many others also. And some days after, Paul said to Barnabas, hey, let's go on our second missionary journey. And visit our brethren in every city where we preach the word of the Lord and see how they do. Look what happens. And Barnabas determined to take with them that vagabond who deserted them, John, whose surname was Mark. But Paul said it's not good to take him with them because he departed from them when they were in Pamphylia and didn't go with them to the work. So here, the Holy Ghost had called out Paul and Barnabas to go together, and now there's a big fight, and Barnabas takes Mark, and Paul takes Silas. They have a church split right there in the book of Acts. And so it says that the contention was so sharp. These guys are mad at each other. They're supposed to be apostles. And they're mad at each other. They departed asunder from one another, and Barnabas took Mark and sailed to Cyprus, and Paul chose Silas, and they departed, being recommended by their brethren unto the grace of God. And he goes through Syria and Cilicia, confirming the assemblies. Oh my goodness, the Holy Spirit said Paul and Barnabas, and now Paul and Barnabas are split, and they're going their different ways. And we see Barnabas takes Mark and goes back to Cyprus, and Paul takes Silas, and they go through Cilicia, and they're going to go back to the places that they already went to. They're now starting the second missionary journey. And what do we see in Acts 16, 1 through 4? They came to Derbe and Lystra. And look at this. Right there was a certain disciple named Timothy, the son of a certain woman, which was a Jewess and believed, but his father was a Greek. Uh-oh, here we got, your daddy's a Greek. And it was well reported of by the brethren, though, that were at Lystra and Iconium. Him would Paul have to go forth with him and took and circumcised him because of the Jews which were in those quarters, for they knew that his father was a Greek. And as they went through the cities, they delivered them the decree to keep that were ordained to the apostles and elders which are at Jerusalem. Now, wait a minute. Paul just said you didn't have to be circumcised, and now he's circumcising. What's going on? Well, his mommy's Jewish. And so, therefore, he needs to follow the Jewish law, unlike the Gentiles. Now, Acts 16. Let's see. Verse 6 through 9. Now when they had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia, they were forbidden by the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. And after they were came to Mysia, they essayed to go to Bithynia. So let's look at the map here. Let's look at all these places. Okay, here we are. Okay, here we go. right there, they were in Antioch, and they decided to go through Cilicia. They go to Derbe. They go to Lystra. And then they're going into Phrygia. You can see what I circled there. And from there, they go to Mysia. And the Lord tells them, don't go to Bithynia. So instead, they go over here to Troas. Remember Troy and the big horse that people were inside, and then they jumped out and killed everybody? That's there. That's where that happened. And then from there, they're going to go to Samothrace, and from there, they're going all the way up here to the Macedonia area, and they're going to go to Neapolis and Philippi. Okay, so what do we see here? It says, the Spirit suffered them not. They came passing by Mysia. They came down to Troas. And guess what? If you go on our tour, you're going to be there. Sign up now. Okay. We're going to go to all these places, guys. It's going to be incredible where all this happened. And it says they came down to Troas, and a vision appears to Paul in the night. And there stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over here to Macedonia and help us. So what do we see in Acts 16, 11, and 12? Loosing from Troas, we came with a straight course to Samothracia, and the next day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is the chief city of that part of Macedonia, a colony, and we were in that city abiding certain days. Oh my goodness. We're going to go to Neapolis. It's one of the places we're going to be going to. It's called Kavala, Greece right now. But we're going to be there. We're going to go to Philippi. That's where the book of Philippians is. Okay? We're going to be visiting on our tour, not only to Turkey, but also to Greece, the Isle of Patmos. But we're going to go where the book of Philippians, the book of Colossians, the book of Galatians, the book of the Thessalonians, the book of the Corinthians. I mean, we're going to end the whole seven churches over there in Turkey that John wrote about. The whole New Testament, we're going to be covering the end of August, 1st of September. It's only 7 months away. Okay, now, the reason why I wanted to go through all of that, because we're going to be jumping into the book of Galatians next week, looking at it in more detail, and you're going to see why he wrote when you understand who he was writing to, these people that were worshiping the sun, the moon, and the stars, Zeus, and all of that. Okay, so with that, let's stand. And let's pray. Avinu, Malkeinu, our Father, King, we just thank you so much. Father, I pray that you would give all of us ears to hear, eyes to see, hearts to understand your word as we connect all the dots that are just scattered throughout the Bible. We want to bring them all together in a cohesive unit so we can really understand what you're trying to communicate to us, what we can learn. We know history repeats itself, and we know that these times are coming back, Father, so we want to be the kind of people that learn from history so we don't make the same mistakes. So I just pray right now, Lord, that you would be with everyone here. Give them a safe trip home. Give them a safe trip back. And Father, I just pray that your spirit would move mightily within each one of us, both to will and to do of your good pleasure. And even as you told Moses to tell Aaron to say this prayer over your people, not only would you bless them, but you're going to put your name on each and every one of them. Ivarekeka Adonai Ba'ish Mareka, Ya'er Adonai Panavileka Vihuneka, Yisa Adonai Panavilecha Viasem Laka Shalom. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In that most wonderful name, Eyeh Asher Eyeh. We'll see you next week. Oh, Monday night. Don't forget Monday night right here, Pesach Wolicki, Monday night. Monday night right here, Pesach Wolicki. Thank you.